In 1982, Leicestershire, Tim and Chris Stamper founded Ashby Computers and Graphics Limited. This was their first attempt at creating and selling games for themselves rather than for anyone else. Choosing the popular ZX Spectrum, the brothers created the addictive platform action title Jetpack under their company's public title Ultimate Play the Game. Within 2 years, working 18-hour days, 7 days a week, they created some of the most popular and well-known titles on the computer, such as Sabrewulf, Lunar Jetman, the seminal Night Law, and many more. They continued churning out hits until 1985, when they sold the brand to US Gold in its entirety and moved on. And by this point, they had discovered the Famicom, a new gaming console from Japan, and believed that the future of gaming was in home consoles rather than computers. During their years of working on the Spectrum, they had figured out how to reverse engineer games for the Famicom and created a subdivision specifically meant to create software for that platform. They named it Rare. After they sold the Ultimate Play the Game brand, Rare became their sole focus. Taking the samples they had created to Nintendo in Japan, Nintendo were impressed by what they had created, but also by their initiative. Nintendo saw an opportunity for a popular European developer to create games on their new system and gave them the green light to effectively create what they wanted in the knowledge they would get the games officially licensed. Rare began creating games in earnest, games such as Nightmare on Elm Street, Hollywood Squares, Slalom, Captain Skyhawk, RC Pro-Am, WWF WrestleMania, Battletoads, and ports such as Marble Madness and California Games cemented them as one of the most prolific developers of the generation, releasing around 60 games in just 5 years, including some for the Game Boy. This extreme output did have its drawbacks. The games they produced were not as innovative or creative as their games on the Spectrum. However, this did little to dampen the company's fortunes. They had effectively gone international. The NES was not well known in the UK at the time, so whilst the brothers lost some fame at home, they gained it abroad. By the early 90s, Nintendo was ready to leave the NES behind, but this meant that Rare would lose its cash cow. Creating games for the SNES was not so simple, and they would not be able to keep up the release schedule they previously had, which had netted them such large profits. They decided to go in a different route and release fewer, more technologically advanced games. They decided to invest in Silicon Graphics workstations. According to David Wise, the composer at Rare at the time, these machines costed £80,000 each, and Rare purchased 2 of them. They used this machine to make a pre-rendered boxing game, which wowed Nintendo when they showed them. Their technological advancements, alongside their excellent reputation as a reliable developer, gave Nintendo the impetus to purchase a 49% stake in Rare, which led to them effectively becoming a second-party developer. Nintendo gave Rare full access to their catalogue of IPs, and for their new advanced game, they chose to use Donkey Kong. Lead designer Greg Mayles stated that the experiments with the new graphic system led them to create a method they called advanced computer modelling, but actually implementing this new method in a real game situation would be incredibly difficult. 12 people were assigned to the project, more than Rare had ever assigned to any single project before. However, this figure is somewhat disputed. Brendan Gunn, technical programmer on the project, stated there were as many as 16 people working on the game. Working with the new SGI workstations proved a daunting task. According to Gunn, it would take at least an entire night for the machines to render a single 3D model. Additionally, they required massive air conditioning units. But despite these issues, Gunn stated that when the image had finally rendered, it looked like a real solid thing. The first obstacle for using the new technology was getting the animation right. Originally, the team went to Twycross Zoo to study gorillas with the intention of potentially tracing their movement, as many games did successfully at the time of humans, such as Prince of Persia. However, they discovered that the way gorillas actually moved in real life was not suitable for a fast-paced video game, so they had to start from scratch and create the animation entirely by hand. Mayo stated that they went through 15 different versions of his movement, with DK's movement in the final game based loosely on how a horse moves. Using the 3D technology they had developed created some new efficiencies in game design, especially with the animation. Once a character was modelled in 3D, they was able to view it at any angle and set the model to what was needed for the animation frame, which was then rendered into a 2D image. This saved much time over the older method, which required every frame to be drawn individually, whilst now it only has to be modelled individually. At the time, there were rumours in the gaming world that Miyamoto did not approve of Nintendo's decision to let a Western developer create a game for their flagship console, with one of their most recognisable characters. However, this claim is not corroborated by many of the developers on the project at the time, with Greg Males stating that Miyamoto gave them several pointers throughout the process, such as DK's tie. The reason that many of this is rumour is that Chris and Tim Stamper famously sheltered their developers from outside pressures and would impose a culture of secrecy on the development of a new title. This means that any feedback or interference from Nintendo would go directly to them and not necessarily be passed on to the rest of the team, with Gunn stating that you'd never really know if it was their idea or coming from Nintendo. Rare took inspiration from Miyamoto's games, such as Super Mario Bros. 3, when designing the levels. They wanted to create a game that had a flowing feel to it, and that experienced players would be able to blast through levels in a single run. For example, ropes would always be swinging towards you when you first see them. Nintendo placed a huge amount of trust in Rare. They rarely intervened with the development of the game, letting the dev create the game essentially how they wished. Up to this point, Donkey Kong did not really have a universe. The games that starred the character and his descendants were basic arcade games and did not have much in the way of world building. This gave Rare the unique opportunity to be able to create a world around the character rather than have any particular style to stick to. They originally envisaged the main character to be Donkey Kong, with Donkey Kong Jr. as his sidekick. This didn't pan out because Rare redesigned the character and Nintendo gave them the option of reusing Donkey Kong Jr.'s original design or instead creating a whole new character. They chose the latter option, which became Diddy Kong. According to Males, the team came up with a number of different names for Diddy Kong, such as Diet DK, DK Lite, Titchy Kong, and Dinky Kong, before settling on Diddy Kong. The gameplay mechanics surrounding Donkey Kong and Diddy Kong evolved over the course of the project. The original idea was for the second character to act as an extra hit, akin to how mushrooms work in Mario. This eventually expanded into being able to tag the other character whenever the player wished, to incorporating simultaneous two-player gameplay if the player chose the option. As the series went on, this became a core feature of the series. An unexpected obstacle with the new 3D technique was the backgrounds. The backgrounds used up a huge amount of memory due to the physical size of them and the fact that they did not want them to repeat. They used a method by cutting up single screens to obscure any repeated elements but still retaining the 3D modelled quality as much as possible. David Wise originally assumed that he wouldn't be creating the music for the game. As it was a huge Nintendo property, his assumption was that one of Nintendo's audio team would make the music for the game. Tim asked him to do a few demos for the game, and Nintendo liked them, so he ended up creating the entire iconic soundtrack, along with another musician at the company, Evelyn Fisher. The soundtrack has been noted for its extremely high quality, and is well liked to this day, creating a number of iconic motifs, which have become linked to the franchise inexorably. Wise stated that, after developing for the NES, the Super Nintendo sound chip was like Christmas. However, limitations meant they still had to hand code the music in order to save memory rather than use a MIDI file. The entire development took around 18 months, astonishingly quick for a game which had made such huge technological advancements in so many areas. According to Gunn, this came about due to Tim Stamper's management style, in which constant but subtle pressure was placed on the team to keep making things better, to innovate, iterate and improve, constantly taking it to the next level. This did place some stress on the team, but it also meant that they was able to work at the height of their abilities, creating something truly outstanding. This meant that the team didn't want to stop. Gunner stated that stopping work on the game was like having your toy taken off you, as there were many more features they wanted to include, if given the time. According to a 1994 Nintendo Power article, Tim Stamper estimated that the combined time the team had spent on the game would equate to 18 man years of effort, the most ever spent on a single game. Whether or not this is accurate, it's clear they did indeed spend a huge amount of time, with the long hours and intense work ethic at the company being legendary. The conference in which they announced Donkey Kong Country has become famous in gaming history. The audience believed they were watching a development title for Nintendo's next generation console, but when it was announced that it was actually a game for the Super Nintendo, everyone was stunned and the reaction was huge. Renaming the company Rareware, they finally released Donkey Kong Country in Christmas of 1994, a game which sold incredibly well across the world. The first Donkey Kong game developed outside of Japan, it used pre-rendered 3D graphics on a console and became the second best-selling game of all time on the SNES, shifting 9 million units. The CGI graphics and two simultaneous playable characters wowed reviewers and gamers, positioning Rareware as a top developer. It had a huge effect on the gaming industry at large. The Sega Saturn and PlayStation 1 were launching in Japan around the same time, and this kept Nintendo firmly on the scene, despite being on a 16-bit console. The advanced graphics of the title led Nintendo to be able to bluff the power of the SNES, making it seem like the console had plenty of juice left to give, and it worked, with sales remaining strong right until the end. Whether or not one likes Donkey Kong Country, it's impossible to deny the effect it had on the gaming industry. Rare proved that it was possible to take an old, partially forgotten character from the past and reinvent them in such a way that they became a major force in the industry once more. Whilst many gamers choose style over substance, Rare decided that they would go for both, creating a game that pushed the SNES to its absolute limits, reinventing what was possible with a 16-bit console. It was the game which made Nintendo survive the Sega Saturn and PlayStation 1 in their early years, and it proved that Western developers could create huge hits just as well as the Japanese ones. Today, Donkey Kong Country is a fun, difficult platformer with great music and nice graphics, but it is one of the most important games ever made.